Welcome into Rover Sports, guys. We are here finally on Zoom, joined by my good buddy Pigskin Pete. And Pigskin, how are you, man? How's your week going?
I'm doing great, man. How you doing, Spencer?
Doing really well. And the NFL draft is over. Do you miss the draft? Were you sick of the mock drafts? I mean, I'm curious, like, are you sad that draft season is over, or were you ready for it to happen?
I'm sad the draft season is over simply for the fact that we have to wait another 3 or 4 months for real football talk. But as the draft as a whole is exhausting, I don't like mock drafts. I never did one. I tried to do like the first 2 or 3 rounds on some videos. And
you were spot on with Luke Falk.
Yeah, I was. Now, but I was spot on with Baker Mayfield and, right. And Saquon Barkley. After that, it fell apart.
You were, yeah.
But that's true for everybody, though. That's my whole point with mock drafts, is that it's like the college basketball bracket during the NCAA tournament, is that once your first 2 or 3 guys don't get picked where you take them, it screws the rest of your whole roster up. So,
sure.
No, the NFL draft, for somebody like me who loves both college football and NFL football, is one of the best, most compelling days of the year, and it's awesome to see. But I am kind of glad it's over. It's kind of like that big weight being lifted off your shoulders. Now you know where everyone's going and what's going on, and you can start speculating on when they're going to start, how are they going to impact your team, was it a good pick, was it a bad pick, that sort of thing. It's interesting, and that's what we'll be talking about for the next few months.
Yeah, especially like the quarterback position, because you can always weigh that out and who's going to be a bust, who's going to be Blaine Gabbert, who's not going to be, you know, who's going to be successful. And when we look at this NFL draft class and these quarterbacks, it almost seems to, like, I don't know, you are on Twitter, but it seems like everybody has a voice now. Like even people that almost never seem to have a voice, like it seems like so polarizing, the Josh Allen talk. I don't remember growing up and like debating somebody about Jake Locker like 24 hours a day. You know what I mean?
Well, that's true. But see, I was one of those assholes on Twitter that was propping Josh Allen up. So, You know, I mean, YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, it brings all the trolls out. It brings all the so-called experts out, like me.
Right.
I'm not an expert, but I pretend to be on TV. But you're right. It sparks a lot of conversation, and a lot of it is just a bunch of nonsense. It doesn't matter what you post. You could post that Tom Brady is an elite quarterback on the internet, and there will be 50 comments that says that Tom Brady is not an elite quarterback from every, you know, jack off in the country who doesn't like the Patriots. So it is what it is.
Well, I'll tell you, Pigskin, I mean, in this draft, like, there's two names. One thing about Twitter, though, is it is almost like a mob mentality, and that I do like that you're on the Josh Allen bandwagon, because almost everybody will say his completion percentage, the fact he's from Wyoming, and then they'll, like, argue, like, why doesn't Lamar Jackson get the same hype? But on, like, Twitter, everybody loves Lamar Jackson, and in actuality, I don't love Lamar Jackson. So, I don't know. It's kind of like a mob mentality. Like, everybody was saying Josh Allen was terrible, and everybody loved Josh Rosen on Twitter. You know what I mean? So, it sometimes is a mob mentality, though.
It definitely is. And this is one reason why I'm either a complete genius or a complete idiot. Now, I'm erring on the side of a complete idiot. I prefer to think of myself as an idiot. But I was propping up both Josh Allen and Lamar Jackson. To a degree, I don't think that Lamar Jackson is the best quarterback, second best, third best quarterback in the draft. I'd never said anything like that. But I do think that Lamar Jackson did deserve to go in the first round, and I was happy to see that happen. And I do think that Lamar Jackson is going to end up taking that job, that starting position from Joe Flacco, quicker than we think. Conventional wisdom would tell you he's going to sit down for a year or two. I think, based on Joe Flacco's, well, first of all, his on-play record the past couple of years. Second of all, his injury history is that he will end up starting probably at some point during the regular season this coming year.
Yeah, the one thing is with Flacco is that I've always loved Flacco's arm strength, but he's so apathetic, he doesn't seem to care. But I will say this about Lamar Jackson. If Lamar Jackson is great, then I want you to I definitely want you to take credit for it, because I mean, you watched him at Louisville a lot. And against, even against Clemson, he struggled. Against the SEC, he would struggle, Pigskin. And that's why I'm not convinced that he's going to be successful. He can't throw an out route. He can't really beat you from the pocket. Is he going to hold up, you know, or is he going to get hurt by running around? I just see I'm not really a believer in Lamar Jackson.
All right, so here's why I disagree with you in part and agree with you in another part. I do think that Lamar Jackson does have the potential to be a good pocket passer. And that's where everyone disagrees with the whole premise of Lamar Jackson. They think of him as just a running quarterback. His only real knock coming out of college was his intellect, which it's hard to judge just by watching somebody or hear somebody talk based on their intellect. He has a huge arm. Yes, he can run and is a dynamic runner. He did have a winning record against the SEC. You just said he didn't, but he did.
Who did he beat?
Well, I think he definitely had a winning record against Kentucky that they played every year.
Maybe. One time he lost. Hey, he lost 2 years ago.
I don't know what – he was at least 2-1 against Kentucky. I don't know about the rest of his games. I don't know how many SEC games they played.
Right.
But my whole point with Lamar Jackson is that people have been pigeonholing him into – being a wide receiver or a running back or something other than a quarterback, when he's clearly not. He said he wasn't. I can't even catch the ball very good. And I think that people are shortchanging him and putting him in this box. And I don't agree with the box mentality. Let's put it this way. I think that Lamar Jackson is going to be a better NFL quarterback than Joe Flacco. Joe Flacco won a Super Bowl. I'm not going to take that away from him. That's a feat that most quarterbacks do not accomplish. Mm-hmm. But Joe Flacco did not win that Super Bowl. Let's not be twisted here. The same way that Peyton Manning did not win that Super Bowl 3 years ago when they played against Carolina. The defense won that for Joe Flacco. The defense won that for Trent Dilfer when Trent Dilfer won it when Ray Lewis was there. Joe Flacco is an average, below average quarterback. He is. He's on his way out. Otherwise, the Ravens wouldn't have drafted Lamar Jackson where they did if they didn't believe in him. And I think in the right system and given enough time, am I saying Lamar Jackson's going to be a Super Bowl winning top five quarterback? I'm not saying that. All I'm saying is that he's better than probably 20 of the starting quarterbacks in the league right now.
So do you see him as Tyrod Taylor, Robert Griffin? Do you see him as Mariota?
He's a better runner than Tyrod Taylor and a better passer than Tyrod Taylor. He is more talented than Tyrod Taylor ever thought
about. He better be.
Yeah.
He better be. I'll tell you what, though, Pigskin, like Flacco, he did have that 1 year that was – I think Ray Lewis, like, kept Flacco afloat, like, kept him focused because, I mean, if you remember the playoff run, though, I mean, he did hit the bomb, you know, against Denver when he needed to. Raheem Moore got beat. He hit an 80-yard bomb. Then in the Super Bowl, he was very good versus the Niners. And then, of course, you know, the Patriots come back in the second half. He did play well, but he is apathetic. The whole offense, nobody seems to care there. His completion percentage is super low. So I look at Lamar, though. He had a couple of games like the Purdue game, North Carolina this year, against Clemson, against you guys a couple of years ago last year, where the kid stepped out of bounds down 8. So we'll have to see. Deshaun Watson was steady the whole time. Lamar is up and down. And that's why I don't really believe in him. I don't really at all. Believe it or not.
Here's my other thing about Lamar Jackson, though, is that, you know, Deshaun Watson is clearly a better football player than Lamar Jackson is. I'm not going to dispute that clearly. I think that Lamar Jackson, I think that Deshaun Watson, rather, is one of the best quarterbacks in the NFL and definitely was in college. But Lamar Jackson was a little bit of a product of the team he played on and the system he played in. Mm-hmm. He wasn't developed as a passer at Louisville that much, even though he has a huge arm. He had flashes of that, and he played on a pretty average team. Louisville was. He right. was their team for the 3 years that he was there, especially the last 2 years. And I think that if you can put him in a system that develops him as a passer, and you can utilize his physical running ability, that he does have a chance to be a starting quarterback in the league as long as he can stay healthy.
Absolutely. I think it's going to be exciting. I mean, he did show flash a couple of, you know, deep ball throws, but again, he just needs to pick up an NFL system. Will he be able to make the reads necessary going from Petrino to the NFL? We'll have to see. I'm not on Lamar train. You are, and that is fine. We have Pigskin Pete here, and Pete, you are a Carolina Panther fan. I wanted to talk to you about their roster. I was looking at it the other day, and it seems like you guys stocked up on the cornerback position. I mean, Daryl Worley, I never knew that much about him. He landed in Philly one day, and he's already arrested. But we won't talk about Worley. I want to know about the Dante Jackson kid from LSU. I want to know about James Bradbury, who from a national perception I don't think has been all that great. But you guys took a lot of cracks at the apple here with your secondary. So talk about some of the corners on this team right now.
Are you getting me worked up here? Because we've had personal conversations offline about what I think about Marty Herney as a general manager. And I completely trashed him. And I give Marty Herney an A++++ for the draft. First of all, DJ Moore, the first pick at a Maryland wide receiver, I absolutely loved. Now, I will admit, I wanted Ridley. When I saw Ridley on the board at that pick, I couldn't believe it. And I wanted him. But when they picked Moore, I was sad for about one half of 1 second. And I was extremely excited. DJ Moore was the best wide receiver in the Big Ten. There's not even a thought about it. He's a game changer, prototypical wide receiver, big, fast, physical guy. I love the pick. You just mentioned Dante, cornerback out of LSU. This guy is a complete ball hawk, interception machine. He reminds me a little bit of Richard Sherman. I'm not saying he's going to be Richard Sherman, but he is a cover nightmare for wide receivers. He's a ball hawk, and he's a very good tackler. So I said before the draft, I said, this is what I want. I want a deep threat wide receiver. Got it. Cornerbacks. Got it. And him and Rasan. I think Rasan might be a safety. But either way, defensive backs.
Yeah.
And they picked those up. And I also said that I wanted a tight end to precede Olsen because, you know, Olsen is a great, great player. He's only got so much time left or he might get injured. And they picked up Thomas from Indiana, which I was super stoked about. And they picked him up in the fourth round. And I think that what Marty Herney did for the Panthers way exceeded my expectations for what they were going to do. And I couldn't even be happier for the way the draft went for the Panthers.
Right. You look at Jackson, like the only knock on him is his height, like 5'10". But this guy could be a press corner. Trey White was very good with Buffalo last year. It's kind of like similar. The guy probably does everything pretty well. So looking at this like defense – I think that you guys got Dontari Poe in the offseason. The D-line, you still have Julius there trucking along, Mario Addison. So talk about this defense, like the strengths of this team. You guys have Mike Adams, who seems like he's 40 years old, still out there. Talk about the strengths and what you might be a little worried about, like when you look at this defense.
Well, the strengths are definitely the front seven, always have been, probably always will be. I mean, you can tell me a time that you can remember in recent history where the front seven of the Carolina Panthers hasn't been their strength. It's been the core of their team for a long time. Thomas Davis being suspended for a couple of games is a problem, but I think that they can get through that, and it's only a couple of games, so thank God it's not for longer. I still have pause about the defensive backs. I mean, yeah, we drafted great in the defensive back position, but we're talking about rookies here, so it's going to take a little bit of time for those guys to develop. Luckily, they have some veterans to lean on. I was super, super stoked when they picked up C.J. Anderson yesterday. Now, I know that C.J. Anderson has not been a top 10 running back in the league in the past couple of years. But the bottom line is they already had Christian McCaffrey. They already have Christian McCaffrey now. They got rid of Jonathan Stewart, which went to the Giants in the offseason. And I was looking and praying and hoping for them to get a power runner in there, somebody to complement McCaffrey, because McCaffrey is not a between the tackles running back. He's not a short down back. He's going to catch the ball out of the backfield and do some exotic plays. And he's very, very good at that. But we needed a guy to fill that gap. And we got that in C.J. Anderson. It was only a 1-year deal, but I love the pick. And so I think that the Panthers, based on what they did in the draft, based on what they've done in free agency so far, and what they have returning, they are in much better position than I would have imagined, say, 4 or 5 weeks ago, that they would be to make a run at that NFC South title this year.
I want to mention two names to you, and I want to get your thoughts on them. The first is maybe one of the most intriguing players on the entire roster, and that's a second round pick, Curtis Samuel. Is he going to have a role? Can this guy get on the field? Can he be a receiver? Can he be a running back? I love the versatility kind of that he presents. What about him? What do you think?
Well, first of all, I like Curtis Samuel, and I actually caught a lot of flack from Carolina Panthers fans. Carolina Panthers fans, I have more problems with than the Clemson fans when I make Clemson videos. Carolina Panthers fans are very, very adamant and passionate about their football team, which was one of the reasons I love them. But I made videos saying that I want a deep threat receiver. I want a deep threat receiver. That's what I think we're lacking. There are a lot of Carolina Panthers fans out there that consider Curtis Samuel to be their deep threat receiver. Mm-hmm. He just hasn't produced enough for me to believe in him. Mm-hmm. I think that he is great. I think that he has speed. I think that he has hands. I think he has everything you would put on paper as a physical talent to be an elite receiver, especially an elite deep threat. He hasn't shown that to me yet. He drops a lot of balls. He doesn't show up. He doesn't run crisp routes. I'm not completely sold on Samuel. I would love to be, and I hope that he ends up being the guy that we think he should be. I'm not completely sold on him yet. That's just me.
Yeah, he might be a tweener. I got you. At least, see, you're real, Pigskin. At least you're not all, you know, sunshine and roses here.
I catch a lot of flack for that. Trust me.
Yeah, that YouTube, like, it's like when you insult something about the team, it's like then you hate the team.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
Or you're a hater or whatever. So sometimes we look for that gray area. The last question I'm going to ask you about the Carolina Panthers is, well, I could go in a couple of directions. I mean, I want to first ask about North Turner. Is Cam going to throw the ball deep this year? What do you want to see North do with this team right now?
Yeah, I want to see that. Here's what I want to see the Panthers do. I want to see them do the opposite of what they did last year. There's a lot of Panthers fans out there that love to see Cam Newton run the ball. A lot of them that hate to see him run the ball. I'm on the camp of I love to see Cam Newton run the ball. It's like what he said last year before the season. It's like lying without the roar. You don't have a 6'6", 275-pound quarterback and not run the ball.
Right.
Yeah. Could he get hurt? Yeah, he could. He could also get hurt getting slammed on his shoulder like Aaron Rodgers did last year. I don't want to hear that crap. You can get hurt doing anything in football. It's football. They run the ball with their backs and their quarterback.
Yeah.
And they take shots down the field. That's what I like to see out of the Panthers. That's what the Panthers have done well for 20 years. And that's the reason that they've been to two Super Bowls as an expansion team in the past 20 years. And that's what I want to see them do. And I think that if they can do that, they will be contenders in the South.
Against the Cardinals in the NFC Championship, Cam was at peak of powers. Even last year against the Vikings was the perfect example of a Cam game. When he would run the ball, he took off like 80 yards and just so dangerous. I completely agree. 6'6". You know, I wanted to so we are bouncing around the NFC South here with Pigskin Pete. You guys can follow Pigskin Pete on YouTube, Pigskin Pete. Matt Ryan signs to a deal. Are you a guy that's scared of Matt Ryan? Are you in the Ryan camp?
No, I'm not. Matt Ryan doesn't scare me at all. The Falcons scare me.
I love that.
The Falcons scare me as a team because they have been a nemesis of Carolina in the past few years. So is New Orleans. Matt Ryan does not scare me. I put him slightly above Joe Flacco. I think that he is more of a benefit of a great football team and great schemes and great coaching than he is of his own talent. Now, I'm not a Matt Ryan hater. I do not think that Matt Ryan is a bad quarterback. As a matter of fact, he's probably a top 10 in my opinion. Some would have him higher than that, maybe a top 5. He's a top 10 quarterback, starting quarterback in the league. So I'm not going to take anything away from Matt Ryan. Now, my problem with Matt Ryan is he's extremely inconsistent. With the amount of talent that he's had over the past few years, he has underachieved. I'm not going to blame the Super Bowl loss a couple of years ago to the Patriots on Matt Ryan. That was completely the coaching. They should have been running the ball and not throwing it. He has Julio Jones. He had two dynamic running backs, a couple of dynamic receivers, a great offensive line. There's no reason if Matt Ryan was in the top five quarterback that they shouldn't have won at least one Super Bowl by now. And if Matt Ryan is the starting quarterback for the next five, or how long was that contract for?
I think it's probably five. I mean, but it's crazy.
If he's the starting quarterback for the next 5 years, as a Panther fan, I am a happy man.
I can, and listen, I look at Matt Ryan. I don't think he's near the top 10, so I'm even going to go. I am totally not in the boat of Matt Ryan. I mean, he did play well under Shanahan. I'll give him the Seattle game at home and the playoff games when they were rocking that 1 year. But he's not a fit quarterback. He doesn't throw it deep, and I was rooting for him desperately to beat the Eagles last year, Pigskin. He doesn't take chances with the ball. He kind of pisses me off. Like, even in that Eagles game, he doesn't ever make the big play that's going to beat you. When he's on the road, he is so gettable. You know, here's the thing, man. I watched Jameis Winston play you guys in Carolina. Jameis scares me a lot more than Matt Ryan. No one talks about Jameis. Everyone talks about Matt Ryan. I think Jameis is a bad dude. I think that Tampa Bay is a threat. I really do.
That's a very interesting take on things, because I agree with you. I think that Matt Ryan, he is not the dart thrower. He is not the game ender. If the game is on the line in the fourth quarter, you do not want the ball in Matt Ryan's hands. I completely agree with you on that. I think that Jameis Winston has some turnover problems. Let's be honest here.
Yeah.
But I do agree with you. I think that Jameis Winston, I would trust the ball in Jameis Winston's hands in the fourth quarter with 2 minutes left before I would trust Matt Ryan. I completely agree with you on that.
Yeah, and it's funny. Like, I was just thinking, like, sometimes I just go for the day. I drive a lot. I think about things that I could talk about on my show, or just, like, debates or, like, football takes and stuff. And you look at Matt Ryan, and I actually compared him to Eli Manning in my head. And Matt Ryan's, like, a lot more consistent. He's kind of – he is, like, an accurate passer, kind of. He can move the ball. But Eli will take those chances and win a game. And just Matt won't ever do that.
Yeah, I'd rather have Eli than Matt all day, every day, and twice on Sunday. Yeah, for sure.
Exactly, because, on the road, just Matt Ryan just won't win you games. And
that's one of the things I love about Cam Newton, is that he's the ultimate chance taker, and he's succeeded more than failed from taking those chances. If Cam Newton was the same Cam Newton we all know but never took chances, they'd be 9-7, 8-8. Chance-taking Cam Newton has taken him to a Super Bowl and won the division 3 years in a row, or three out of the past 4 years. And that's really what it comes down to. I completely agree with you. Matt Ryan is a very vanilla quarterback.
He really is. And you look at Cam, and we're just spitballing here. I thought that game against the Saints was heroic. It reminded me of Brett Favre going down there when Greg Williams was beating his head into the ground. I mean – Cam, like, the way he got off the mat, the McCaffrey throw, he was, like, 20 yards away from damn near coming back, even though Graham Gano was missing chip shots. Like, I look at this whole division, it is just so elite. And I almost feel bad for you that you're with the Saints and even the Bucs. You have, you know?
Yeah, the Bucs don't scare me so much.
They don't? What about Ronald Jones? What about Carlton Davis? I mean, and also the Buccaneers. I mean, you look at the Eagles, what they did to win. The Buccaneers, listen to this defensive line, Pigskin Pete. I'm going to make you an argument why I think the Bucs can win the South. McCoy, Vita Vea, Noah Spence, Bo Allen, their defensive line is jacked. Vinnie Curry, Quan Alexander, David, their linebackers are fantastic. Like, I think this front seven is damn near the best in the whole division.
Now, there's no way for me to combat you basically saying that we don't know what's going to happen this year. All I can say was what's happened in the recent history. And the fact of the matter is the Bucs have had tons of talent. I mean, they've been picking high in the draft every year, just like the Browns, you know, for the past 4 or 5 years. And they're underwhelming. I think it's more has to do with the coaching than the players itself. So the Bucs don't scare me. You're talking about, like you said, maybe the best, most toughest division in football in the NFC South, with the Panthers, the Saints, the Falcons, and the Bucks. And out of all four of those teams, the Bucks scare me the least.
Scare you the least. That's interesting. Yeah. I mean, Atlanta does have a talented roster. The Saints, I guess, came out of nowhere last year. I actually had the Saints doing well last year. Did the Saints surprise you last year?
They did. They actually absolutely did. I thought that it was going to come down to Carolina and Atlanta, and I actually thought Atlanta was the better team than Carolina overall. But, yeah, the Saints, man, you can't underestimate – I learned this last year, and I should have known this just by being a football nut. You can't underestimate Drew Brees. The guy is an absolute fucking magician. Mm-hmm. And with Kamara coming out of nowhere and just taking the league by storm, and, of course, the wide receiver talent, Michael Thomas, I mean, they did surprise me. I never thought, even when they won the South, that they would be a contender to win the Super Bowl. I never thought that they were good enough to do that. But I was shocked that they were so dominant in the South last year.
I'm really sad that they didn't get a crack at the Eagles because they absolutely were Super Bowl contender, and the Vikings and Case Keenum, that pained me a lot. I think the Saints actually were a big contender for – they easily could have won in hindsight now, right? I mean
– in hindsight, yeah, I guess they could. But because of the offense, their defense was much improved from what it normally is. And I think it's going to even be better this year, which is scary. But – yeah, I agree. Their offense was top three in the NFL, and their defense was much better than it used to be. And they've always really relied on offense. So it was a little bit of a scary thing that they were so good. And if they're better this year than they were last year, then that's even scarier. They probably could be an NFC champ contender and possibly a Super Bowl contender.
They're going all in with Marcus Davenport and this team this year. Pigskin, yeah. I wanted to thank you so much for joining me. I just have one more question here. We're also going to put this up on your page as well after the show. And by the way, Jet Central was supposed to join us. His power went out. He just texted me. So,
and Jet Central, pay your power bill. I'm just kidding. I love Jason.
I think it was an excuse, man. I think he met a girl somewhere or something. He's blown.
Hey, what? Well, you can't blame him for that. Come on.
Yeah, but I don't know about the old power bill, but gosh.
I'm just kidding. I love Jet Central. He's my boy.
Jet Central will be back. He will be back. I think the NFC, this is maybe my favorite question I'm going to ask you all day, and I could always talk about the Panthers all day. And you have to pick three of these teams that scare you for the NFC. I'm going to mention five, so we'll try to, like, remember the list, okay? 49ers, Eagles, Vikings, Rams, and Giants, okay? So the Giants, Eagles, then the Rams and Niners, and then the Vikings. Pick three teams that scare you and leave two off the list of teams that you think are a little overrated.
You know what? For once, I kind of agree with you on all of that, so – I'm going to say, well, definitely the Eagles.
You think the Eagles are going to be back with Carson Wentz? There won't be a
– Yeah, I think that the Eagles, if they can win a Super Bowl with Nick Foles, are definitely going to be back in the mix with Wentz healthy.
Yeah, I just hope Michael I would say the
Vikings are going to be the overrated one. I'm going to take the Vikings as overrated. I think they'll have a great defense. I'm not sold on the new quarterback with Cousins, right? Cousins is
yes.
I think that the 49ers are going to be a contender out of nowhere. That might be the dark horse of all of the NFL this year. Garoppolo and all of the crazy moves that they made, the 49ers are on my radar right now as a contender in the NFC. The Rams, another one. The Rams might have – you said before we made this video we're going to talk about the biggest winners of all the NFL draft. I put the Rams at number one in the winners of the draft. I put the Giants probably at number two or equal.
What did about the Rams draft?
Well, not necessarily the draft, I'd say, but the free agency.
Sure.
They loaded up on talent, the Rams did. And they were a great team last year. They already had Gurley. And Goff's playing great. And they picked up some really great players. I know they got rid of Sammy Watkins, but they replaced him. And So who is the other ones? The Rams, Vikings, Eagles.
It's funny. I wanted to stop you, though. I think the Rams are the overrated one because I don't believe in Jared Goff. And you do have all these personalities like Talib and Marcus Peters that need to, like, gel quickly.
Well, I can kind of agree with you there, but let's look at that division. Let's look at the NFC West. So who in the NFC West, other than as far as the quarterback position goes, you say Goff's not, you know, impressing you, or you think he's overrated. So who else do we have? We have Rosen.
It's a good division for quarterbacks, but I guess the Cards are not that scary, you know.
But you have Rosen, who's going to be a rookie.
It's a great quarterback division.
You have
Russ Wilson.
You have Russell Wilson, who's a great quarterback, but he's playing on the Seahawks, and the Seahawks are, let's be honest here, they're not on my radar at all. Garoppolo, who came into the last four games of the season last year looking like the MVP of the league.
And then
you've got Goff. So I don't know. I don't think that when you look at the quarterback position in that division, that how can you put Goff low on that list? I mean, really, as far as a team around him, he's got really
– I'm putting him really low. I just think he had 1 year last year, like Cooper Kupp, and like Todd would carry him on these screen passes. Like, I still don't think he's that much of a talent. He's just not a talented guy.
You cannot dismiss like a team. You cannot dismiss a team that comes from 8-8 to all of a sudden winning – what did they win, 11 games?
They should have beat Atlanta. I mean, yes, Sean McVay. I love Sean McVay, so –
yeah,
listen, Sue is scary. It looks great on paper. I just have to see.
So to answer your question, my two teams that I would dismiss from the East or from the West, rather, NFC West, would be Seattle
and the Rams. No, you love the Rams.
Yeah, Seattle and probably the Cardinals because I don't like Josh Rosen and they're just not good enough yet.
Right. Josh Rosen, Arizona.
Don't get me started on Rosen. We'll be here for another hour if we start talking about Rosen.
He might be pretty good. Josh Rosen, he's a little scary, though, with that whole, you know, top 10 comment thing. I think he could be good, but I just wouldn't want him as a GM either, man. So we could root against him. Hey, you have to like at least that Rosen is so far out west in Arizona where, like, I've never met a Cardinals fan, so it's perfect, you know?
Well, he belongs there.
It's not like a polarizing place. It's not like he's like Steelers or something where it's Josh Rosen all the time.
I think it's good Josh Rosen's on the West Coast or semi-West Coast because he's a West Coast kid, and we all know how I feel about West Coast kids.
Hey, listen, you could just sleep through the 4 o'clock games. You ain't going to watch that.
I'm not going to sleep through it. I'll watch the highlights and hate on them then. How about that?
Exactly. We'll cherry pick the bad stuff. Pigskin Pete, man, thanks so much for joining. Going to put this on your channel too. A lot of fun talking ball with you as always, man. And we'll be back real soon to do another vid.
I appreciate it. Pigskin Pete checking out.